Wait, just interesting point, you know, this actually adapted from your design.
I know, I recognize that, but I never use it. Okay, Clara. But, correct. Actually, I can use this computer also, but... Okay, presentation.
Not maybe.
Where's my presentation?
Present. Wait, but it's not
mirrored. Huh? Can I present the view? Then you spawn one more window out.
Yes, yes, yes.
Then you drag the window across. This view is better. Okay.
Okay, so...
Okay, I've been blocking the thing, so... I'll just sit down. So, good evening, guys. So, my name is Lester, and on my left is Melvin. We work in the engineering team in TechNasia. So today we are here to present how TechNasia deals with WordPress. Essentially, so as some of you might or might not know TechNasia, we are a media, jobs, and events platform. We also part of YC, which is Y Combinator as well, in 2015. Yeah, so we have about 100 plus people across 12 cities, Singapore and Indonesia being the biggest office. So we have editorial, product, community, event function, as well as engineering team as well. So TechNasia is about 5 years this year. We turned 5 this year, back in March. So back then, TechNasia was known as Penn Olsen before they rebranded. So from the start, when TechNasia was Penn Olsen, it has been on WordPress. They developed using a very customized version of WordPress done by an agency, and they did literally a shit job in doing it. So there's like SQL code all over Teams, no proper naming functions, and global variables everywhere. So so did quite a lot of custom coded plugins as in ourselves, because most of the third party plugins just doesn't meet our requirements. They like overuse the database. Okay, so I should go and show some pictures, which basically takes you down memory lane. So when I first joined TechNasia in about 1st of September 2014, this is the layout, which is basically still a WordPress team. This was we also started forming the product team by then. Then after that, we iterate over. You can see we moved to a list view, and we have featured articles as well on the right with nicer images. Then we also changed. We started having our own membership system, which is also based on WordPress, but the logging in and the forget password, everything is all custom coded, integrated with WordPress rather than using their own functions. We also have trending, if you see there. So trending is calculated based on Hacker News rank, which is the time decay over time, and based on the number of comments. Yep. And after that, we move on to here. We also integrated Facebook and Google login as well to the site. Proxying through WordPress sign and registration function. Then after that, we revamp our layout to be more user-generated focus. We also started having a community team. So we have a discussion, we have panels, online panels. We also have AMAs as well. Then after that, we move on to a more flat, wider design, which basically not much new features except the ability to submit a post. So some technical background. So when users submit a post, it basically goes to WordPress. Yep, it will be as a pending review. So the community editor will just have to go through, look at it, see whether there's any editing, and you will just click publish. And it will go on to the front page. Then after that, we did a major revamp last year. This is the part that we moved from WordPress team to fully React front end. So our WordPress is just basically an API API gateway, I would call it. So we also removed the sidebar. So basically there's only one reading column here, and with infinite scrolling as well. Moving to React allows us to do quite a lot of stuff that is much difficult to accomplish on traditional WordPress team. So we just launched Jobs last month, almost exactly 1 month ago. So we also did this in React, but the backend is on Laravel rather than WordPress. So basically TechNasia infrastructure front-end proxies through Laravel as well as WordPress API, depending on which page you hit. So now I'll talk about WordPress as our backend. So WordPress API is actually split into two portions, the REST API infrastructure as well as the REST API endpoints. The infrastructure has been around since 4.4, which is launched December last year. So prior to 4.4, we have been testing it on using a plugin, the REST API plugin. And the other half, which is the endpoint, is already in the plugin itself already. So if you want to test it before it gets into the core, you can just download plugin and try. So because we do not have, we are not using WordPress endpoint infrastructure, we are not using the endpoint like WP JSON, WP V2 post. Instead, we are using our own namespace like Tag Nature 2.0 post. I will explain why we name it in the next slide. So we use Tag Nature, it's avoid conflicts, and as well as our own identity, which is, yeah. So we use 2.0 rather than V2 because if you want to validate a URL, float is easier to validate rather than a string and a float in front. So we just go with 2.0, it's much simpler. Or we can even stick to 2 eventually. So of course, WordPress payloads also returns a lot of information that we don't need. There's like filter, there's raw and stuff, but totally we don't need at all. So we basically create our own standardized payload that our clients can consume, and it's standardized across all WordPress posts and pages. Yeah. Okay, so the reason why we moved to an API so that we can have a unified API. The same API can be consumed for our iOS client, our Android client, and our web client. So we don't need to do basically two portions, which is the WordPress theme as well as an API for the native client. We just have one API and all the different presentation layers can consume the API. Because we're also moving towards a more service-oriented architecture. As mentioned previously, we are using Laravel for some data, like for our staff database and our jobs database are based on Laravel. So whereas for the main more content related features, we are using WordPress for editorial and community submission as well. Also separation of concerns, front-end engineers need not touch the WordPress side and WordPress engineers need not touch the front-end side. Yeah. And also hiring WordPress engineers is very difficult in Singapore at least. So it's much easier to hire a JS guy to implement some API rather than hiring a WordPress engineer to do a JS team. So if you split the infrastructure into two, it's more scalable for your company. So you just need to have the API ready and any, and you can just go and charge guys to do it. So of course, we can't use most of the WordPress plugin because all of them rely on the WordPress team. So we custom coded almost quite a lot of it from command upvoting to notifications, registration, login, community submission. Yes, that's all I can remember. Okay, we still use third-party plugin, but it's more for backend purposes like AMP. So whenever we publish a post, we will basically generate an AMP URL for Google, as well as Facebook instant articles and Google XML sitemaps to get Google in then. So for TinyMCE, the editors are using TinyMCE so that they can do their posts in WordPress. Of course, it's impossible to build everything ourselves. So here are some of the services that we use. As you might know, WordPress search is seriously horrible. It's myself as good as stop searching at all. So we are using, our search in Tag Nature right now is powered by Google Custom Search. So whenever you type in anything, our WordPress API will proxy it to Google and we'll return you the results that Google gives us. Of course, it's not free. So it's about, I think $50 a month or something. Yeah. So Jetpack notification, we need a notification service. So we don't want to build one for ourselves. And Jetpack notification is a closed service. So we went with getstream.io. Good thing it's free for I think 3 million requests, but 3 million notifications, but per month. We got much less than that, so we still can use it.
Until they change
the
rules like Evernote.
Yeah, unless they change the rules like Evernote. Okay, Jetpack Proton also is also another image compressing features, which doesn't work for use case because it requires WordPress team. So we are using a service called Kraken.io. It's cheap. It's not free, but it's very cheap. It's about $5-$10 a month, I guess. Mm-hmm. So whenever how it works is whenever users upload editor upload an image to a media library, before that it will basically go through Kraken.io to optimize the image. Then we have a custom thing that uploads to S3 directly. Yeah, so the Kraken happen immediately after they optimize the image. So yeah. So you might, if you are doing thinking of like making WordPress scalable, you can take a look at these services. When you have an API, you need to deal with authentication, authorization, and session management. That's a very common problem. For authentication and authorization, we still use WordPress as a single source of truth. For quite a lot of WordPress functions, which is like WP sign-on, WP register and stuff, can be called in your plugin or in any custom implementation to add a user to the database or even to forget password to generate a token. So we are still using WordPress for our authentication. For authorization, we are also using WordPress as well. So like, for example, if a contributor submitted a post, he can't edit the post anymore. So how we do that is we basically use the user can function in WordPress to check whether he has roles and capabilities to edit the particular post. So for session as well, we also, because we shared session with our Laravel services, we can't use the WordPress session because WordPress is only understood by WordPress. So what we do is we store our user data in Redis so that both Laravel and WordPress can read the same session details. We also overwrite WP session data with determine current user. So if you need to have your own WordPress session management, you definitely need to override this filter so that you will know where to find. How does WordPress know which user does the login user belong to and where to find them? So we store basic session information in the cookie, and the cookie is sent along with the API request on the web or via authorization header for native iOS and Android clients. Yep. Okay, so another thing we did very custom made, which I can't find any solution on WordPress, is basically rate limiting and caching. So API is very prone to abuse because it's open. Anybody can just call an API 1 million times or something like that. So what we do is we rate limit most of the get and put and post requests to discourage spamming. And of course, we return you proper status code like 429 when there's too many, when this happens. So if you're logged in, we limit based on your user ID. If you're logged out, we limit based on your IP. So for caching, all we get, because most of our users are not logged in, which might not be a good thing, but it makes life easier for us because everything can be cached. Like the post you see can be cached easily. So all our get requests are cached for probably like 5 minutes. So even because TechNation has a lot of traffic, we have like 3+ million page views every month and like 300 to 800 people online at any time. So even a 1 minute cache, it helps a lot. It's better than not having any cache at all. So this is probably my advice to, if people want to take a look at WordPress API, I hope this will eventually be in a core. Because once you open an API to the public, any block caching and rate limiting, with an open API, you can easily bring down your server easily. Yeah. So for the future, some of the pipelines is like, is there a way can we bypass WP admin? Like what Automatic did to their Calypso. So technically we can create a desktop app with React and Electron, package it. That's what WhatsApp does to their native desktop app, sort of. So that we can create a customized app for our editorial to enter in content. So they just have to focus on creating good content rather than meddling around WordPress, which is one of their complaints as well. One of the complaints. Yeah. Of course, if you're going to do that, you need more APIs to write posts, create categories, and all those things. And now I'll pass on to Melvin to talk about the React as a front end.
We ask you questions first?
Oh, you asked. Okay.
I have a few, actually. But one, so even at WordPress.org, we also know the search ads. That's why we use Google, actually.
Yeah.
If you go to WordPress.org.
Yeah, it's a Google.
Yeah. But anyway, what did you consider Elasticsearch?
We don't want to have our own infrastructure.
Ah, I see.
As far as possible, right, we try to use service, because our team is small, probably about 10, and we are always busy doing other stuff. So if money can solve a problem, you use money to solve a problem. We don't want to do it in-house, given our small team.
Spoken like a VC-backed service.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes. Second question. So what about, so image-wise, I mean, with the recent change to compression, to 82, is there really a need for
We haven't explored it, but so far Kraken serves us quite well.
Okay.
So we have no intention of switching yet. Yeah, we haven't really explored. I know they optimize the image in 4.5, I think.
Yeah,
so we haven't really explored it. But I'm not so sure whether it can beat Kraken or not. Kraken even tells you how much size you save optimized per month.
Okay. Last question. So you're talking about the API getting abused, right? So why not just put in authentication for it?
That means a lot of people in the room can't read TechNation because you need to log in and you will lose a lot of traffic.
Okay, because you have to
read. But with abuse, if all the get requests are cached, it can't really be abuse. Cache is very fast.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we are using AWS.
PHP when
you
cache.
Yeah. Yeah, using Elastic Cache on AWS. So,
cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have a question. Just now you mentioned that WordPress can't do some stuff that React can do, right? So I'm not sure if now we'll be talking about those things, but
yeah, you can ask.
Yes, yes.
No, as in both, like for both of you, like what were the things that WordPress cannot do? Then they can talk about what you can do.
Infinite scrolling.
Really?
Easily. Easily. Oh.
Install Jetpack Infinite Scrolling.
But you can't control.
Okay.
You can't customize a lot of things. The problem we have WordPress is it wants you to do a certain direction, but for us we have to be very flexible.
Yeah.
And comment system. Melvin did a very good job in the comment system thing, so he wrote everything from scratch. So the comment system. Yeah. But the comment system is another thing that's quite horrible on WordPress. Mm.
You don't want to use Disqus.
We migrated from Disqus.
Well, the comments class is getting a lot of love right now, so it'll be improved.
Yeah, that's why he did most of the stuff before even actually the comment class.
Yeah,
it helped him in some of the stuff actually.
So is comments still in the WordPress database?
Yes, database, WordPress database. So everything you see, user accounts, login, authorization, and comments, posts, is all in WordPress database. Mm. The only thing not in WordPress database is the jobs that we launched and our startup database. Mm. Yeah. Everything media content related is on WordPress. All the images are still all hosted by WordPress, yeah. So it's like in the WP content folder, hosted on S3.
So the WordPress database structure is still very sound?
Yes. In fact, we try to make it as default as possible. Uh-huh. Because whenever you like install the plugin, you'll create thousands over rows.
Yeah.
So that's the reason why I wrote one on plugin WP Suite, which is to basically get rid of all those things that is not in the default WordPress installation.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So while I was doing the cleanup, because when I came 2 years ago, it was horrible. WordPress is in a horrible state, as in tech nation, not WordPress. Yeah, the agency really did a horrible job, seriously. You just get it to work and it will crash and probably 100 users online at the same time. Yeah.
I'm so interested, we should talk about the agency.
I can't remember the agency yet. I don't think it's around anymore. So yeah, like, if you want to do things properly.
There's a question. You can someone.
Yeah, someone. Yes, sorry. The guy in the room. Yeah. Yeah. You have any question?
I have two questions.
Sure. Go ahead.
One question is because I don't know the name of it, but I know there are forks outside there. Take the WordPress framework and something like they're trying to use it as a base for their own project.
Yes.
So, can you say your site is
actually? Our site is still based off WordPress, but more like a plugin to a WordPress installation. All the tech initial you see is done as a tech initial plugin, a custom plugin. So eventually, if we remove the custom plugin, it's still WordPress. Yeah, we did not modify anything to a core files at all. So we can upgrade anytime. In fact, our WordPress is always up to date. Yeah. So. Yes, that will show. So that we fix. Because let's say if there's a security release, it's very difficult to fix a fork repo compared to an original WordPress. Correct, we are working around WordPress rather than modifying WordPress.
Then the question on the user, do you still mix your users, your internal users with external users?
We give them different, is it called roles? Yes, different roles, yes.
It's still the same.
Yes, it's still the same. But because we limit the capabilities that a default sign up user can have, we call it member lah, the capability, so they can do slightly lesser stuff lah. And also if you type WP admin on the normal user, you won't get to the WordPress dashboard at all. So our WordPress dashboard only can be allowed to access on the admin. We check the admin role. Yes. Yeah, any more questions before I pass to Melvin? No. Okay.
Hey, password.
Password.
Okay, hello. I'm going to talk about the front end. Basically, a lot of things is actually not very WordPress, it's so bad with me, actually. So, how do you go next?
Enter. Next AD.
Okay, so actually, when we actually started looking at the redesign, like last year around August or so, actually 2015 was actually a very interesting year for front-end development. A lot of things took up, and then we've seen that actually React popularity has like exploded. A lot of things have been going on with the React framework. Angular 2 was also being announced, and then they were like, it's not actually very backward compatible with Angular 1. Firstly, it's on TypeScript and all the stuff. And then ES 2015, which was a very big significant update to the JavaScript language.
Standard.
Yeah, standard. Was released. and there's a lot of changes. As far as I know, this year they have decided to make increments smaller right now. So 2016 was out like few weeks ago, but not much changes. But 2015 was so big that there's a lot of things going on. So between that, for us in Tech in Asia, we had to choose between a framework, and we actually think React is like the most definite solution for choosing a framework between the others like Angular and React and Ember. So one of the benefits for React is actually very performance driven. It has something called the virtual dome system. So basically, just think of your HTML as like a tree of stuff. So within the HTML tag, you have like a div tag, a div tag, and a p tag, and all the stuff in there. So for a single page application, what you will just going to be on the same page, but it's just rewriting all the divs at the same time. And so it can be actually very expensive. What that React does is actually checks on each component and check whether the data has changed on a certain component. Then they actually save the entire DOM tree in memory and decide like which trees have been changed based on the change of data. So let's say the red one is like once in change. So they will only re-render the ones in red and those children inside it. So in that sense, a lot of they are able to re-render stuff at a very quick rate. And a lot of new front-end frameworks like Ember and Angular are looking towards doing this kind of like similar implementations into improving re-rendering in single page applications, which is like for front-end, for our case. So another thing is that let's talk about WordPress theme template. We are all used to something like throwing things into HTML and mixing up stuff in PHP like this. So for example, for WordPress theme, we have the template tag here, putting the ID in there, and then putting the title and putting the content. Yeah, this is taken from 2016. That's 2016 now?
Yeah,
I didn't know.
It's 2016 now.
Oh, okay. Yeah, been a while, sorry. So yes, basically we are used to doing that. So for us, trying to do React is like simpler learning curve. This is a React syntax with ES2015. So you can actually do the same thing, but right now every template is actually a component by itself. So for example, you have a page component that actually displays the page itself. And these are all the ES2015 stuff, like ID, title, and content, get it from a certain state of property of the component, and just return it as the same thing as putting HTML and props, combining all these things together. You can do for loops and everything together, all in the same file. So to that is quite something similar that we know like from our WordPress background. So it's easier for us to go and go through. So that's why we kind of choose React. So let me talk about some of the React ops stuff that we kind of use. So basically, firstly, let me talk about Babel. Babel is actually something that became very popular last year. What you have seen just now from React is actually something called JSX, which is a custom syntax made by Facebook and the React framework to go and generate something and return something in HTML. So they need something to transpile it back to JavaScript. And Babel, they actually had their own transformer at first, but they decided to move this to Babel because Babel is gaining popularity as something that you can write 2015, ES2015 and anything newer JavaScript code, and they will convert it back to ES5, which is compatible with all the existing browsers. Babel is actually something that we need to use to transpile this. And another thing that picked up popularity also last year was Webpack. If you heard something like front-end build tools like Grub or Grunt, this is another one incoming very famous one in front-end development, which is a lot of magic inside. Too much magic. Sometimes we also don't know what's like when we change the config, something that breaks the whole thing. They have a lot of things inside. They can load. They actually convert all things Babel and all those things, convert, read CSS and everything. And then, but the more important thing is that they have two things. First thing is code splitting. So we have like a lot of pages, and how we are not going to let the user download one big gigantic JS file with every single page. So what Webpack allows you to do is actually code split into different parts of the page. So let's say you are at our jobs page, then we just need to go and load the relevant job JS files in one chunk and just load it based on it. So there's no need to go and load other things that is not necessary. in this sense, we are able to keep the load, the script, asset script that we want to load smaller. And another thing that made Webpack famous with React was actually hot reloading. So basically, when you're doing development in with Webpack, all you do when you change everything to file and you're running that script, the watch server script, it will automatically react to it, refresh without you manually clicking the refresh button on the browser, and it's very fast. They're able to do incremental updates in less than a second. So that then, assuming your code is not complex enough.
So you guys just sneakily change articles without even
knowing? Yeah, no, this is not. We don't do it in production. This one, I heard NFL does it in production. They have a hot reloading script somewhere.
Oh.
Yeah, interesting. But I don't know how they do it. It's a lot of work done. So they have, we kind of use that. There are actually a few more, but these are probably the most essential things that we need to use. And then when we move, when we go and have, like, we have a lot of data going in, so we have posts, and then some posts will be used for different kinds of components, probably in the single post page or the post list of post page and all stuff. So we need to find a way to, like, manage all the data in, like, a central state there and move it and move the data and centralize the data so we know where all this data changes and everything. So Facebook actually uses something called the Flux architecture, created a Flux architecture where all data goes in a uniform unidirection, one direction. And then basically this is one of the thing that they do. If I'm not wrong, WordPress Calypso uses the vanilla version of Flux, which is this. What basically do it views is your components basically. Whenever, let's say I request a post, it becomes an action, it dispatches it and all the changes will go into the store. So the view will keep taking it from the store. It gets a bit frustrating first if you are doing things like that, because but it's actually easier to understand the flow this way rather than you having data binding. Then you are confused like, hey, where this part change and where this thing change. So over the course of last year, there was like a lot of Flux variants coming out. A lot of people say, hey, why not we just do this? And but I guess in the end, probably end of the year, Redux became one of the most popular ones. So we actually started with Flux and then we moved to Redux earlier this year. Not much changes, it's just that they don't have a dispatcher, they only have one store, and then they have reducers, a lot of reducer on managing individual type of stuff in stores. Yeah. So for routing is actually totally separate from WordPress. WordPress has no control over like what does the routing in.
You don't use React API or?
Yeah, that's one of the problems for us, but yeah.
Which is good. So that the editorial team will think they are prototype before they keep asking how to change it.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. So React has a standard router, basically. So React router. And then we also have, actually, from there, we actually have to handle a legacy problem. Like, let's say, all the most popular pretty permalinks that everyone will use is something like /post. Yeah. That's an interesting problem for us. So how do we actually solve it? So we actually have a React router that catches all the important routes that we have. So /job/login/whatever. Yeah. So the final one is actually the post itself. Anything else to wildcard for everything. And we actually go and call the WordPress customer, which Lester wrote, that handles the slug. So when it handles the slug, it returns us a post object. Then we can see whether the post type is a post or a page. From there, then only then from there we are able to render accordingly, like whether a post component or a page component. Mm-hmm. Yep. And so that's how we kind of do it. So another thing is SEO. SEO and SPA is for search. I mean, even if you're on Angular or on Ember or on React, SPA is search engine optimization and single page applications will never work well together because most search engine robots do not know how to interpret JavaScript code. But recently, Google is able to handle this stuff recently, but you can't just rely on Google because people do share stuff on Facebook. Especially for us, it's very important for us in Tech Nation because a lot of people want to share our articles on Facebook. So what we actually had a trick was to actually had a headless browser to go and take a screenshot of the browser page and then re-render it. So our proxy will actually intercept this and actually send it to a pre-render service. It's essentially a phantom instance that actually captures a screenshot of thing and returns it to them. So eventually you should be able to see something like this. Yeah. Correctly. And then we also had to use React Helmet to when, which is done by NFL engineers. They done a great job on doing this to actually dynamically handle changes of the, when they read the component, it will just override the meta text that is being used by the component to go and like display the appropriate meta text. Yeah. So here are some little tips that we have to starting out React. So you probably need to cover the basics. Actually, React has quite a it has a simple learning curve by itself, but to develop a web application, it gets even steeper. Yeah. So from here, you can actually use Facebook's thing first. And then when you move on, then you need to go and figure out, like, you need to start with a good boilerplate. A lot of the front-end development scene right now is there's a lot of complaints on something called JavaScript fatigue, because everyone is having a lot of types of boilerplates and configurations and all the magic in one, throwing in all kinds of different frameworks to go and find the essential correct way of creating a proper web application using React. So my suggestion is probably to go and find a very good boilerplate. I think React boilerplate has a command line system. So yeah. Then probably relearn JavaScript. For us, we actually relearned JavaScript last year when we tried to create it. So if you want an extra challenge, you can actually figure out functional programming, because Redux is actually quite done in a very functional way. So there's a free book that I think this is a great book to read. So, but it's not that easy to consume if you are not a recursive person, basically. Then Redux has a very good video course done by the creator itself. So this is the one that is worth checking out. So any questions? Fine. Yes. Yeah.
Why did you choose to use that instead of because I know some caching mechanisms is better.
Yeah.
So that you can just do the caching kind of mechanism instead of. How do you choose that instead of?
Like, that you need to have pre-render is a headless browser basically.
Because I think some caching plugins. Mm-hmm. Rendering of your page in HTML as well.
Correct.
So your backend really doesn't, only because it's a React kind of thing.
Yeah, it's a React kind of thing. It's just re-rendering the front end, and it needs to, the browser needs to be able to evaluate the JavaScript first. Yeah.
And more importantly, the plugins will not run.
Yeah, the plugins will not run.
Correct.
Because they don't use the theme, the plugins will not run anymore.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Any other questions?
I asked you this the other time, so how does preview work?
Preview?
Yeah.
Oh, preview. Actually, what we did is actually, there was a hook to change the UI.
Yeah, there's a hook to change the URL.
So we actually have a custom, we actually created a custom page in React that handles that route.
Okay.
And we'll call accordingly. And he checks the permissions. The API checks the permissions, whether it's okay, then it will render it out. Yeah. So there's a lot of like, hooking and filtering stuff. You know what I mean? Yeah. Okay. Any other questions?
Are your cards available for downloading? Since I didn't write down any.
The slides.
Slides.
Can.
Yeah, the slides are available.
That's a recording as well.
Oh, that's a recording as well.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Boom. Any other questions?
No, I think we have consumed quite a lot.
Yes.
As usual.
Okay. Yeah. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.